Hey y'all, Scott here. Oh god, this is gonna sound so mean. I'm sorry if this comes off as negative. This redesign fucking reeks.
Nintendo taught me it's okay to be self-conscious about my appearance since they obviously were with a 3DS after changing it like 12 times. Console redesigns are inevitable. Nothing's perfect the first go around, and redesigns give console manufacturers the chance to reignite interest in their system, make it with cheaper parts, or just simply make it better stylistically and or functionally. Now while some console redesigns really hit it out of the park and not only looked better, but worked better, some may have only done one or the other, and some just straight up did neither. So let's take a look at console redesigns throughout history and see whether they were a worthy upgrade or make me vomit. Now, redesigns have been around since the dawn of time, i.e. the late 70s. Some redesigns acted like they were straight up sequels to the original models, like the Fairchild Channel F2 and the Intellivision 2. These being solid upgrades to the originals, albeit with the Intellivision 2 being made much cheaper. The Atari 2600 got a few facelifts, most famously being the Atari 2600 Junior released in 1986. It wasn't officially subtitled the Junior, and for good reasons, that name reeks of I'm not buying that, I'm too old for it. It was simply a redesigned 2600 released at a budget price to allure all those value seekers out there. There were a few other variants of the console released, one with some switches rearranged, and one with an all-black finish, nicknamed the Darth Vader model. Now all these redesigns looked fine, but in my opinion it ain't an Atari without the wood grain finish. Redesigns start to get a bit more interesting with the NES. The original model is quite the chubby piece of shit, if I do say so myself. Yes, this is one of the most iconic looking video game systems ever released, but it's a meaty little guy and is crazy prone to hardware failures. I'll bet that if you own the original NES right now, it either has some problems, doesn't work, or has been refurbished or fixed at some point. After the Super Nintendo hit the scene, Nintendo put out a redesigned NES, positioning it as a budget gaming system. It takes a few design cues from the Super Nintendo, as it's a top loader, which is what this model is generally referred to as. Now, rumor has it, this system was designed as a way to combat complaints from consumers, as people would put their drinks on top of the NES like a coffee table. They would fall over and damage the system. This new one? Yeah, I can't confirm, no drinks fit on here. The top loader is the definitive official NES model. It rocks in almost every way. It's way more compact, is much more reliable, and can play stuff like PAL games. But it has one glaring flaw. Oh god, that's gross. Yeah, instead of AV out, this thing only has RF. That's disgusting. So instead of the picture looking like this, it'll generally look like this. On top of that, being RF only means this thing is almost completely irrelevant to use on modern TVs. However, you can mod it for AV out. The problem is you definitely need some modding skills or need to spend a pretty penny to have somebody else do it for you. However, various people called Nintendo back then and complained about the lack of AV out on this system. In response, Nintendo offered to officially mod their consoles to have AV out, so there do exist official versions of the system with AV, however, they are incredibly rare. It's just so odd that it was like this straight out of the box. The Japanese Famicom version of this redesign was literally called the Famicom AV. It included AV out, and it was a big part of the branding. If you're willing to spend a ton of money to not only buy this system, but mod it as well, you might want to consider just picking up the high-end aftermarket NES systems with HDMI, like the AVS for Metro USB or the Analog NT Mini. Similar to the NES's revision, the Sega Master System 2 was a budget console redesign, but it really doesn't hold a candle to the original release in my opinion. Some Master System games came on cards, which you would insert into a slot in the original model. Hope you weren't planning to do that on your Master System 2! This only plays the cartridge-based games, which, I mean, the majority of games were released on cartridge, so it's not a huge deal. But overall, the original model plays all the games, and the design is just way more appealing to me personally. The 2 just kinda looks awkward and generic. The original isn't stunning by any means, but it has more personality. Sega decided to strike again in the terrifying world of redesigns with the Genesis, getting 3 major revisions. The original Sega Genesis model is big, bold, and screams the company who made Sonic Forces loud and proud. The second model? Feels a bit tamer. I grew up with this model, and overall everything feels a bit more refined and evened out. However, I do think the Model 1 has a lot more character. It's just so bold. I do have a soft spot for the Model 2, but the Model 1 just screams what the Genesis was all about. And if we're talking character, well, the Model 3 has that in spades. Yes, the runt of the litter. The Model 3 was actually produced by Majesco under Sega's license, and it's always wildly uncomfortable to me when game consoles are about the same size as the games. This one doesn't work with the Sega CD or 32X add-ons, and was just a tiny cheap version of the Sega Genesis. I mean, it works, but now I'd say it's really nothing more than a novelty, a collector's piece, really. The SNES got a redesign late in its life. Blam, this thing is irrelevant. I think it's fine, but I don't really see any real reason to use this compared to the original model. Unlike the NES top loader, at least it has AV out. However, That's all it has. The original SNES allowed for loads more different video outputs, so in the end, this redesign just feels like it's a downgrade across the board. I think the design is kind of boring and it's functionally worse than the original. The PS1 and the PS1. Yes, the original PlayStation's redesign is just called the PS1, and I had this model as a kid. But I didn't know about the LCD screen attachment until way later, my god! I'm personally fine with both of these designs, you can't really go wrong with either of them. The PlayStation brand of consoles would continue to carry the torch of the redesign. Every single one has gotten a facelift, and the first to continue this tradition was the PlayStation 2. This is just one of those before and after ads. Now this is a redesign done right. They literally smashed an entire PS2 into something like 10% of the size of the original. The first model was garbage, look at this thing. Apart with a few swings of a hammer. Now the PS3 was interesting because the systems got better, but worse at the same time. The original version says, I blew $600 to play Ridge Racer 7. This guy had so much useless garbage crammed into it that just made the price skyrocket. Like, look at all the card readers it had. Why do you need these? The PS3 Slim was released as a way to reinvigorate consumer interest in the platform at its lowest point, and it did a great job at it. The price was affordable and the design was much more compact and attractive. However, it ditched PlayStation 2 backwards compatibility. I mean, certain varieties of the original model had it, but with the release of the Slim, PS2 disc support was gutted entirely. But at the very least, PS1 games could still be used. The PS3 Super Slim, though? Yeah, this was pointless. Talk about an odd release. A third console revision is never the most common thing out there, and this just felt like they were cheaping out. There wasn't much wrong with the PS3 Slim, and to just replace it with this wasn't the greatest. I gotta hand it to him though. Can't do this on other consoles. The Xbox 360 had a similar trip down redesign lane. The original model, it was terrible. I mean, it just didn't function well. It failed constantly. The 360S, on the other hand, boy, this is a good console. The 250GB model came with a glossy finish, and I'm pretty happy I cheaped out and got the 4GB model with this beautiful non-fingerprint heavy shell. They redesigned it again to look like the original Xbox One, why? This is another design that just kinda cheaped things up a bit. They removed some ports and it reeks a first Xbox One model. I mean, that's what they were going for, but still. The S will always be the best one in my opinion. Next up, the Nintendo Wii, and if you haven't caught on yet, Nintendo really only redesigns their successful consoles. The N64, GameCube, and Wii U, yeah, those stayed the same throughout their entire life. The Wii's first release is perfect for what the Wii was meant to do. The Wii's second release got rid of the stand, GameCube backwards compatibility, and was meant to be laid on its side. That was a worthless redesign. Speaking of worthless, the Wii Mini! This was test released in Canada around late 2012 until it got a wide release just a year later. This took things a step forward and removed internet access, Jesus Christ. At least the Wii Mini looks more interesting than the second redesign, but none of these models make a case to be bought compared to the first one. I also think the Mini really missed out on a huge opportunity with the lack of internet access. 2012 was the time streaming boxes really started to hit it big. Popping an HDMI port on the Wii Mini, giving it internet access, and positioning it as a streaming box that could play Virtual Console and Wii games could have actually been a huge hit. It did come with a Wii Remote, Nunchuck, and Mario Kart Wii here in North America for $100, and if you did the math at the time, those three things alone would add up to around $100, so you'd be getting the Wii Mini for basically nothing. That didn't stop anybody from not caring about it though. The PS4 and Xbox One have both been guilty of receiving facelifts, and in the Xbox One's case, it just kept getting better and better. The original Xbox One is f***ing terrifying. If Microsoft is capable of releasing a VCR in 2013, who knows what they can do? The system barely had any character and felt like something to sit next to the DVR under your TV and nothing else. Now the original PS4 in comparison, ooh la la. This thing isn't perfect, all these nooks and crannies can build up a lot of dust, but the PS4 has a unique design that's still fully functional. And then they made this. The PS4 Slim always felt so awkward to me. The tiny little sliver at the top just feels weird. The Xbox One's revision, the One S on the other hand, oh, this thing looks sleek, it looks modern, it's everything a redesign should be. Because not only does it look better, but it was upgraded under the hood as well with some 4K support. Now in terms of the high-end versions of each console, the PS4 Pro. This feels like they were thinking, huh, how do we convey to people that this is a more powerful PS4? And then somebody just said, add another sliver. Yeah, I've never been a huge fan of this triple-decker design. I prefer it to the Slim, but not by much. The Xbox One X, on the other hand, is like a tweaked Xbox One S, and I think it looks lovely. The S has a bit more character with all those holes, but the X still looks really good. Now just you wait, because we can't possibly skip over the handhelds. The original Game Boy line got slimmer and better with the Game Boy Pocket and received a backlight with the Japanese exclusive Game Boy Light. I always considered the Game Boy Color to be its own system, but many consider it a half step and it's more of a hardware revision rather than a full-on sequel to the original Game Boy. Either way, it continued where the Game Boy Pocket left off, now with a color screen. The Game Boy Advance is what we call a full-blown sequel and actually became playable with the release of the Game Boy Advance SP. A full backlight, clamshell design, and rechargeable battery make this the definitive Game Boy, with an even better backlight coming in a revised model. And then things got effing puny. The Game Boy Micro was a really cool take on the Game Boy Advance. The problem being, that's all it was. It couldn't play original Game Boy or Game Boy Color. Just Game Boy Advance games. The PSP had a fair amount of releases, with the 1000 model being the first, and the 2000 and 3000 models both being upgrades, but having pros and cons to each. Some prefer the 2000 screen to the 3000 screen, for example. The PSP Go was a mistake. It was a purely digital console, ahead of its time definitely, but it just did not take off. At least it wasn't the E1000, which is just like the Wii Mini, stripping a ton of features including Wi-Fi. Thankfully, the PS Vita has a pretty decent redesign, with its second model featuring a slightly lesser screen, but with most features still intact. I've already talked about the DS line before, so I'll keep it brief. Oh f**k no. Amazing. Pretty good, but they got rid of the Game Boy Advance backwards compatibility, and almost all exclusive features of this console can be accessed on the 3DS, which can play DS games, so what's the point? Big. Now the 3DS. The original model had a lot of little design quirks. The bottom screen would leave a mark on the top screen, a bunch of unnecessary switches and lights, and the glittery finish. All of this was fixed on the 3DS XL. While it was positioned as more of an alternative option to the regular 3DS, it fixed a lot of the little issues with it and made it a more solid system. However, I do have to say, the original 3DS XL feels a lot cheaper than the original 3DS. Oh no. The 2DS was a budget version of the 3DS, without the 3D or the clamshell design. There were millions of people who wanted to play one or two specific games on the 3DS, and that was about it, and the 2DS helped them do that for a crazy low price. I don't like this one. I know a lot of people actually find the 2DS more comfortable to hold, but not me, sadly. The new 3DS and new 3DS XL were hardware revisions of the original models, improving them both in almost every way. Offering face tracking 3D, more buttons, and a nipple. I've never been a huge fan of this C-stick here, but I'd rather have it than not at all. The regular new 3DS is beautiful. I love almost everything about this design. Plus, it has interchangeable faceplates. Oh man, I really prefer the bigger screens of the new 3DS XL. It's a dreadful problem. The new 2DS XL. Nope, that's not a joke. In reviews, a lot of people claim this was the definitive 3DS. Did they even play this thing? Like, it's fine, it works, but I think too many people just made a big deal about the top screen looking like a smartphone and saying, wow, this thing is great. It's not my favorite to play on. Why are the speakers down here? Where my palms would be. The new 2DS XL's placement in the 3DS line is a bit weird as well. It's for those people who don't want to cheap out completely with the regular 2DS, but not spend 30 extra bucks for a new 3DS XL. Okay.
Console redesigns can be a real make it or break it moment for us when it comes to actually deciding whether or not to buy a console, and they can also help a console retain relevancy and not fade away like a fad, like the Tamagotchi or leprosy. Me personally, I have three major deciding factors on picking up a console redesign or not. Yeah, checks out.